Most of us measure our training using some sort of device or app and probably take for granted the science behind it. Recording heart rate, for example, has become one of the more obvious parameters to use when you're analyzing your efforts in training or a race. But where did all of this start? It was here in Finland that Pola designed the first ever wearable heart rate monitor way back in 1977, a groundbreaking move at the time. So today I'm going to be taking a look inside this building, glancing back at the history, discovering how we got to the products that we use today, and going behind the scenes to take a look at some of the rigorous testing required to make such devices. Before delving into the testing labs, I want to find out a little bit more about the science behind monitoring heart rate. And for that, I'm going to be speaking to one of the directors here at Pola, Raja Larkonen.
There was a need from a sports coach to measure heart rate of athletes non-invasively, because you cannot take EGG equipment into the field or forest. And so a professor invented a wireless heart rate monitor. And this wireless heart rate monitor invention was based on the EGG measurement, actually. So it was compared that how you can measure with the small amount of electrodes heart rate and transfer it automatically to the wrist unit. So that was actually the EGG from lab to the field was the base for the whole heart rate monitoring in the beginning. This was the patented feature and the patented creature, the first one ever.
Anyway, enough talking. I think it's time I went and test out some of this high-tech kit. Okay, I have just discovered this quite amazing looking hole. Now, Vesna tells me this is a very serious piece of testing kit. Now, Vesna, what happens inside here? What is this? What are these spikes for?
This is the anechoic chamber. We are using it for testing our antennas, okay, for polar devices. And it's general, it's used for antenna testing. Basically, it tests its performance, not to mention too many parameters like efficiency and gain, okay, which will enable functionality of GPS and BLE on our devices.
And why is it like, why does it need so much testing for a watch? Why is it different on a watch?
Yes, it's interesting. If you have a phone, yeah, the antenna will not have so much body loss, but worn, okay, like all the wearables, which, yeah, are worn on body, have this body loss, which will decrease its performance. So we need to, okay, optimize for the best performance on worn on, yeah, the body.
Okay. And why these spikes? I mean, I want to touch them, I'm not going to, but...
they are basically for? Absorbing different frequencies of electromagnetic radiation.
It looks like a human washing machine that's really comfortable. yeah. Okay, enough talking about it. Can I get my watch tested then? Can we put it in here, the M430, and see?
Yeah, let's...
And have a look?
Right.
So now what happens?
Now we close it, so it means that the... This is completely closed.
Yeah, and it's like a magic trick. I expect something else to come out other than my watch.
Yeah, I'm not going to press a button.
Yeah, I'm going to have a rabbit.
Yeah, but basically then we use our program, which, okay, communicates with that. And
so what's happening inside of that? Is it moving around?
Yes, this it's moving around.
Okay. And you do the same testing for all the products in here, all your wearable products?
Yes, almost all of them.
Okay. Well, as Vesna mentioned, there's a lot of emphasis here on how the watch actually works on the human wrist, but there is only so much that you can expect humans to do, so there are some alternatives. For example, take a look at this. It's a robotic arm. Well, I'm not sure if you've managed to work it out yet, but the arm is actually going for a walk, probably a fairly brisk walk. And as you can see, it's wearing three versions of the M430. And this is so they can get a lot of data from replicating that movement hundreds and hundreds of times, but without any worry of having human error. And you're probably asking why. Well, it's to develop the algorithm so that when we are wearing it ourselves, we can tell, for example, if we're running, how long our stride length is, looking at the cadence. But it can also be programmed to do any different sporting activity, even working on swimming at the moment. And beyond sport, They actually use it to replicate sleep, so it can be kept still with a slight movement like you might imagine on a night's sleep. Having said all of that though, sometimes only humans will do. There were no running dummies to be found, so here I am actually having to do some work myself. Now, we're underground in the polar factory in this bunker, but we're actually replicating a pretty sunny, windy day. So they use this area for testing the equipment under real life, or as real life conditions as you can get. And then on the screen in front of me, behind you, we've got my ECG. So that's being very accurately measured from a belt that I'm wearing. And then with that, I can compare how the equipment actually reacts to these real life conditions. And as the athlete gets a bit hot, sweaty, or in my case, a little bit out of breath. Obviously myself, or anyone else for that matter, can't run a 40 degree heat, for example, for very long, or Arctic conditions. So there are luckily other machines out there that will test such extreme parameters. But all this testing and development happens for a reason. It's to develop new products. So I think it's time we went back upstairs to just see how far Polar have come with their development.
So what we have here, Heather, is the very first prototype of wireless heart rate monitoring.
Yeah.
So what you see here on this little wooden block is like a kind of a prototype coil system.
Okay.
Where they were just testing the apparatus to see how you could get the heart rate off the chest, the signal, mm-hmm. into another device
okay.
that was away from the body.
Got you.
Polar went commercial in the early 80s. In 82, we launched the Sport Tester.
Yeah.
And we had very first products out there, heavily embraced by the triathlete community, you know, the Mark Allens and the Pauly Kirus and these guys. Just a very, very solid product that really set the ball rolling and started to get more athletes at various levels also embracing the technology. This is long before Windows came out.
Okay.
So we had to develop our own computer interface and that kind of a thing. So here's a printer actually where you can literally print out the stats from the training session. So then you get into the, for example, the Vantage series, you see the black device there. What you start to see is a lot of miniaturization.
Right.
The products get into a lower profile.
Yep.
This was a product that was really also embraced by triathletes simply because it was so easy to get the wetsuit okay. on and off. It was so, the low profile made okay. it very convenient. Polar was the very first product or a company that released a heart rate monitor that also gave you cycling speed and distance.
All right.
That was a CycloVantage. That was also still back in the 90s. We were the world's first company to integrate activity tracking into a triathlete product,
right.
multi-sport product. So what we were able to do then is be able to provide the athlete the overview of what happens also just beyond the actual training session.
Yeah.
And this was really a boon for a lot of coaches as well, you know, just to get that overall perspective. I think we're definitely going into that direction where we're going to be able to factor in more of the variables, give you more contextual feedback. You know, if you think about the training load and recovery mm-hmm. functionality, make that smarter. Let it bring on more of the inputs from how well you're sleeping and how your muscles are recovering, what type of training sessions have you done further back, and then how has your body responded to that. That's an example of it. So definitely the algorithms are getting more advanced, and then the computational power is definitely getting better.
All of that has seriously opened my eyes into just what goes into something like this watch that I wear every day to help me with my training. And I must admit, I'm excited to see where the technology is going to head in the future. But right now, I think I need to go and do some work myself, because apparently I have actually only done 49% of my daily activity target. But if you've enjoyed this, hit the thumbs up like button and make sure you don't miss any more videos from GTN by hitting that globe. And if you want to learn how to train with heart rate zones, we've made a video on that just here.